moves in a minute, sir.
No.
We have been around each other too many times for me not to know that you are a dancer.
Oh, well, yeah, yes.
Yes.
But I don't tell people that.
Oh, I'm sorry. Let's go ahead and bring up this photo. Yep, look at that, Chef Tap.
Oh.
Look at Out to Play.
Oh.
I had no idea.
Wait, Kelly, that was 50 pounds ago.
Whatever.
If you can measure time by weight accumulated.
Wait, were you talking like that to the dancers?
No, I was a performing member of 3 different dance companies in my day.
That's amazing.
In another day, in a different chapter of my life. Yes.
You're groovy and you can groove. I like
it. Well, no, I liked it. There's nothing like dance shape because you're strong, you're limber, you're flexible.
Yeah.
And graceful. And so.
Totally, just like me. Oh. Just like me. That's what I say. You just celebrated a birthday.
Yes. I'm an official old crusty man.
Whatever.
Yeah, so 2 weeks ago, I turned 65.
Not everybody, I love age because it's a blessing. Not everybody gets that.
So here's the thing. Don't get old unless you have wisdom to show for it.
Oh, man. It's like the fortune cookie I get but don't understand. That's so cool when you say it.
That's how I'm feeling.
Well, we knew that it was your birthday, so we have wine for
you. Oh, my gosh, this a little bit of Pinot Noir.
I know you
thank
like
you.
Red wine.
Thank you.
Red wine. So for your birthday, this is from our friends at Duckhorn Vineyards, and this is a 2021 Costa Brown Pinot Noir.
Definitely Pinot Noir. Thank you.
I love Pinot.
I'm all into Pinot.
Thank you. Wait, but your favorite is a Burgundy, right?
The red Burgundies are mostly Pinot Noir, so I'm all in.
Oh, I don't know that much about, okay.
What? Now you tell me, now it comes out.
Girl, okay, I'm
just
telling you.
You're gonna go there and not go all the way.
Look, I go to the wine tasting and they're, do you taste the oak? Totally. Like, it just tastes like something's gonna get me to a good time. You know what I'm saying?
That can happen too.
Yeah.
Other
than dancing, were you always into science? Like, when a kid, at birthdays, did you ask for space gifts? I figure you did.
Well, I can tell you. So my earliest, I was 9 when my parents took me to the Hayden Planetarium here in New York City.
I'd never
seen the night sky. They showed me the night sky in the planetarium. There were thousands of stars.
Yeah. And so,
this is beautiful, but it's a hoax. Because I've seen the night sky from the Bronx. There's like 8 stars. This is not the right night sky.
Yeah.
I would later, of course, learn that that was the real night sky. To this day, when I go to mountaintops, the greatest observing sites in the world, and I look up and I say, it's so beautiful. It reminds me of the Hayden Planetarium.
At some point, no joke, you have to come to my ranch in Montana. It is the most beautiful sky.
You know, the last time you had a ranch and an eclipse went on your property, I didn't get a call from you.
I know, but that's because I didn't say, I'm going to invite you. Now I'm saying I'm inviting you.
We got this on record.
But I didn't know that was going to happen in my defense. But it was cool.
Not
to rub it in. But no, it's such a beautiful thing.
Behold. Montana, big sky.
Oh my God.
It's not an accident.
And it feels like you can touch the stars.
Yeah, something I never felt in the Bronx.
Yeah.
That's what that was. By the way, when I was dancing, by the way, I was still studying astrophysics, and I had fellow dancers who were making extra money because I needed money because they weren't paid much.
Yeah.
And one of them said, "Why don't you come down with us?" Because some of them danced at a strip club.
Oh my
God! A guy strip club where
the
women.
Do you have a picture?
No. No. But I just want to clarify.
Make it my birthday.
No, let me clarify. That, so I went, and I was cut and flexed. I could do a full split. So I went to just investigate, right? I wanted data first.
Yeah.
So I go there.
Data?
So I'm watching them come out, and they had asbestos-lined jock straps that had been ignited with lighter fluid, and they came out dancing to Jerry Lee Lewis's song, Great Balls of Fire. Now, let me just say, I'm embarrassed that only in that moment, when I saw their genitals on fire, did I say, maybe I should be a math tutor. But that's stupid.
You're using your dance skills.
I could totally tutor math, and it didn't occur to me to do so.
I'm gonna be honest with you. I've never been to a strip club. Not against them, do your thing. But I've never been to one. But if I were to go to one, I don't think a lot of balls are being on fire at a lot of them. I think that was a very specific strip club.
I'm just saying. At that point, I had other thoughts about how to earn money.
You're like, I'm gonna keep this junk safe. You have a new documentary.
I love that, Earth's Own.
It's Earth's Own.
Like
well,
that.
We're proud of you.
I am from Earth.
You're one of the good of humankind, like mankind, yes. But you have a new documentary, let's talk about it.
Yeah. I served as script editor and executive producer on a documentary that explored anti-science thinking in our culture and how that influenced people to not be vaccinated.
Wait, are you talking about people like flat earthers?
Well, that they would come under the broader category of anti-science thinking.
Oh, you're doing it in a PC way, I see. Yeah. Okay.
Right. Yeah, no, there's a whole camps of people who think something is true that is not.
Yes.
And science, the methods and tools of science are exquisitely tuned to establish and enable and empower you to distinguish what is true when you otherwise think it's not, mm-hmm. or what is not true when you otherwise think it is. And so this is what science does, find objective truths in the world. That's what led to this quote. I say it again. The good thing about science is that it's true whether or not you believe in it.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
Now the moving frontier can be ratty. Okay, but once a result is established and verified by other labs and things, then, hey, we've discovered a new objective truth about the world, and you can't debate that.
Yeah,
and by the way, so I was brought on as script consultant mm-hmm. and then elevated to executive producer by the director, writer, and producer, Scott Hamilton Kennedy, who's mm-hmm. a documentarian. In fact, he's in the audience right now.
Oh.
Where is it? Scott, there
right
you
here.
Go.
I
Scott,
like right here.
Give
yeah,
it up
yeah.
for Scott. He's done other films just trying to explore just how we get truth out there where people think it's not. And this is an important place to be, especially today. We have these warring factions when everyone
especially
thinks
they're right. Especially if you're a
trusted person.
Yes. Like people, yeah.
Entirely.
Because it's hard. Sometimes media, how they navigate it, like it can be hard. Sometimes
right, right.
To know where to put your trust.
So this past week, it premiered in New York, and it's going to premiere in Los Angeles at the end of November. And so if I can give the website, shotinthearmmovie.com.
Yeah. Shot in the arm, that's the book, right? Is what there's the book.
Oh no, the book is something else.
Oh,
I'm doing a lot of different things. Sorry.
Look at you. Okay, go. What's the book?
Okay.
Talk about the book.
So 6 weeks ago, I published a book, co-authored, called To Infinity and Beyond.
Oh, To Infinity and Beyond. Yes, I love it. Buzz Lightyear. Okay.
And it's co-published with National Geographic.
Yeah.
So it's a beautiful book because they don't make ugly books.
No, they're beautiful.
That's not how they roll.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so it's an exploration of what it was to stand flat-footed on Earth, look up, and just wonder, how would you ever ascend? Now, Icarus tried it with his wax wings. They melted, the board died. Okay. But what's your next thought? Is it, I will never try that again, or maybe I should make wings out of a different material next time.
Yeah.
And so this book is an homage to all the people who kept ascending to every next point that was previously imagined at infinity, and then you go beyond it.
Yeah.
So we put people on the moon, but our robotic emissaries have been to Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, and beyond
to contemplate
the origin of the cosmos itself.
It's very smart. It's very clever.
Yeah, that keeps you going. It keeps you in it.
It keeps
us biscuits along the way. Yeah.
Little biscuits. Okay. All right. Let's get to the best and worst part of space. So every time Neil is here, he tells me something terrifying about the universe that I end up googling.
No, because you ask me.
I know. Because I want to know. I'm a prepper. Okay. I like to be prepared. So it's something we call. So you're welcome.
Freak me out.
You know what? In fairness, you're about to scare the hell out of all of us. So go ahead. What's one thing?
Oh, you want to know ways we might die delivered by the universe.
Yes.
Okay, so we just brought back a sample from an asteroid called Bennu. This is an asteroid whose orbit crosses Earth's orbit.
Okay.
There it goes. And any asteroid that crosses Earth's orbit will one day collide with Earth. It's just a matter of when. Asteroid Bennu, it will cross Earth's orbit, and we think it could hit us with a 1 in about 3,000 probability in 2182.
That's not far.
Okay, so, and no, it's not 400, and the asteroid's about the size of the Empire State Building. So, no, it won't render us extinct, but wherever it hit would be really bad. Okay, so, but 160 years, that's plenty of time to find Bruce Willis.
Exactly! And...
No,
get him up there.
Okay, no, there's plenty of time to figure out
no,
how
we might...
No, there's
no way to protect us from that?
No! That's... No. No, we have no... There are no...
Why don't you shoot at it?
No, there's no plans right now to deflect anything. We are sitting ducks. And you know the dinosaurs, had they had a space program, they'd still be here.
Today, we're going to do something we've never done with Neil, a mini planetarium slideshow with photos from the James Webb Telescope. So explain to everybody what that particular telescope
quickly,
is.
Oh, quickly, yeah. It's like the follow-on to the Hubble, mm-hmm. and it's that much more capable. It's specifically designed and tuned to view infrared light.
Okay.
Why? Because galaxies being born in the early universe give off ultraviolet light. And since then, the expansion of the universe has stretched the ultraviolet light to become infrared. So we are going to be observing the birth of galaxies after the universe has already altered the light that comes from them. And that infrared also allows you to peer into gas clouds to see the birth of stars. Oh, yeah.
Oh, these I can't wait for everybody to see these
pictures. Yeah.
Okay, let's move over
to
our studio,
sure.
Planetarium. Okay. Here we go. Here we go. All right. So we're in space. You know what? We're always children. So let's see the first image.
What do we
here
have we
go.
Let's see
first
what we
image.
Got.
What is
let's
this say. One?
Oh, okay.
What is this?
This is the central part of what's called the Eagle Nebula.
Okay.
You don't see the eagle because it's way bigger than this. This is in the middle. And by some, it's been called the Pillars of God.
Ooh.
Because deep within inside, those are gas clouds punching through interstellar space. And deep within them, stars are being born.
Look at that. Barbara Streisand's in the sky. Okay. Next image. Let's
yeah,
see
let's
the next
do it.
One.
Let's do it. Yes.
Okay. We're still floating.
Okay, so this
oh,
one.
Oh, I love this
okay.
one.
Okay.
It looks like an eye.
And my people, we name things like we call them. This is called the Ring Nebula because it's fuzzy and it's in the shape of a ring.
Yeah.
If you look at the very center, yeah. like right here, there's a star.
Okay.
That is the star that released these gases in its as death throes. So that is the remnant of a star like the sun
yeah.
that has given up the ghost. And when it has done so, the outer layers of gas rise up from the surface and continue to expand in the shape of a ring, leaving bare the core of the hot star that is now dead, the Ring Nebula.
I just think it's beautiful. This is my favorite one.
It's beautiful.
All right, let's do another
Keep
one.
Going.
Next image, here
Bring
we go.
Bring them on.
What's next?
Ooh, okay.
Where are we
so
in?
This is, okay, this is another.
Are we Marvel superheroes right now?
Okay, so now watch. So watch. So this is another star that has died.
Oh.
In fact, it has died in recorded history. This is called the Crab Nebula. This is a star that exploded. And this is the guts, the remnants of that explosion that has been expanding ever since it was first observed. This was first observed by the Chinese on July 4th, 1054 AD.
What?
Yes, we have it on record when the star exploded. So none of that was there on July 3rd. On July 4th, the guts, the reason why it's guts, because these high mass stars manufacture heavy elements like nitrogen, oxygen, silicon, iron. These are the elements that are made, that comprise life.
So what happens? They just like float
yes.
off?
So they fly off and then they enrich other gas clouds
oh.
that for the next generation of stars.
Circle of life.
So yes, yeah, so they'll okay. have planets and with the right ingredients, some of them might even have life.
I love it.
Oh.
One more, we have one more.
One more, guys, keep going. Okay. Oh, Jupiter.
Jupiter,
there we go.
Yep.
Okay, so again, Jupiter in infrared light.
Yeah.
But they can move it over to visible light so you can see it. Wait, put the whole thing back there. Where did
put it,
where's
it at? I like
yeah,
that you're
you
still dancing.
Thank you. Right. So we got this spot here.
Yeah.
So in regular light, this would be red. And we call it Jupiter's red spot.
Okay.
That's the official name of it, because okay. that's how we roll.
Okay.
Okay? I'm just saying.
It's very specific.
Right. But what I want you to notice is that on the North Pole and the South Pole, there's glow.
It's like teal. I like it in orange.
It's
yeah.
glowing.
Yeah.
This is aurora on Jupiter. Jupiter has magnetic fields just the way Earth does, and particles come from the sun, and they see that magnetic field, and they split, they collide with the atmosphere, render it aglow, and you get the aurora borealis, the northern lights.
Have you seen the northern lights here?
They're not interesting. My wife is, well, I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
This is me floating away in space.
Okay, no. Not everybody can have a Montana ranch.
I want to see them.
Okay.
I want to see them.
Okay, you'll get them in Montana. We ain't getting it here in New York City.
I know. I've never seen them, though.
Yeah, yeah. So if you're too far south, it's just a kind of a glow. But the farther north, you get to see the colors and the dance of lights as the particles stream through Earth's atmosphere.
As a dancer, you should love it.
So all I'm saying is that when you compare planets, we say Jupiter's really different from us. Well, in some ways, it's not. Yeah. It has aurora just the way we do. And this is a way to compare and contrast objects in the universe.
Yeah.
You can list what's different, you can list what's the same. And by the way, this spot, okay, just for context here, this spot is about 5 times the size of Earth.
What?
So Jupiter has storms that are larger than Earth. Earth would be just a blemish on the surface of Jupiter. Jupiter is badass in the solar system.
That's cool.
Can I say that?
No, you can't.
Same time TV?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. That's so cool.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you so much.
Oh, my God.
I love it. That's so cool. All right, so Neil's new book is called To Infinity and Beyond, and his new documentary is A Shot in the Arm. Be sure to check them both out.